invest a lot of money, millions and millions of dollars, in athletics in general. They don't have to. They could take that millions of dollars and go, we're going to build a new building, we're going to start a new program, we're going to hire different professors. They can make a choice based off of the money that they spend on athletics. But they actually want to spend money on athletics, and not because it's going to get this great financial return, but because it's actually, they believe that through the complete champion approach, by giving you the opportunity to grow not just as athletes, as most of us frankly in this room are not going on to be professional athletes, but they believe that this process that you go in for your next 4, 5, 6 years is going to be beneficial to you in the long run. You're going to graduate and you're going to have a whole bunch of skills that you might not even realize till you're 30, 40, 50 years old, where you kind of look back and go, oh, you know what? Some of those things that actually I was going through at the time, I thought they were ridiculous, but it's actually given me this skill set now that I'm going through this in my life. So that's really important to them. The other thing that's really important to them is that while you're here, we are putting out the kind of headlines that are positive headlines in the community. So doing well athletically, great, that's one way to do positive headlines. Another thing is to be involved in the community. So whether that's through coaching, whether that's through volunteering, whether that's through helping with the flood relief, like there's a myriad of ways that we can be involved in our community giving back. They like that. So if you think, just think in your head right now, based off of what I just said, what do you think is the amount per person in our department? We have approximately 400 athletes. What is Trinity investing in you on a per year basis? So if we just, this is the average. Some people are gonna be lower, some people are gonna be higher, but what do you think is the average per person, per athlete investment per year that is being made? How many people are going, I'll take A, please. Anybody for A?
Does it apply everything?
Everything, okay, yep.
Not facilities. Okay.
We have nobody for A. Anyone for B? 12 to 15? Okay. Oh, we got quite a few. Okay. Maybe about half the crowd are speaking 12 to 15. Anyone taking C? Very popular answer on a multiple choice test. A lot of people like C. Okay. Anybody taking D? Oh, we got a few people taking D. D is correct.
Let's go.
There you go. So. You may wonder, what is included in that? That is, everything that is given in that is all this financial need that you're getting. So it could be need-based financial aid, could be academic financial aid, could be athletic financial aid, salaries for staff, your travel, your gear, this pizza, like all of that kind of gets wrapped into this kind of thing, right? So what I want to talk about today is how then, we're going to talk a little bit about now and when you're an alumni, what do we want to see in terms of contributing back to Trinity in a positive way? Because we've just established, they're not getting any money out of this. This is not this is not investing in Bitcoin. This is not doing anything like that. This is just simply investing in you in the hopes that you, while you're here, have a fantastic experience. And then as you go out as an alumni, you make a positive contribution into the world. So we're going to look at these three things as a Venn diagram for those of you that remember grade 5 math. Humble, hungry, smart. So what do I mean by that? What we're looking for is there's an overlap. You could take a person, very humble person by themselves. They would be an incredible human probably. They might not be the best athlete. They might just always be constantly like, you know what, you go first. They don't really want to compete. Competition's kind of like icky. I don't want to really do that. Okay, but really humble, very nice people. You can take a hungry person, and hungry, I'm not talking about how you felt before you had this pizza. We're talking about someone who is like, they just want to win. They want to do their best. Everything is a competition. You probably know some of these people. There's probably a bunch of them in this room that you're just like, it doesn't matter if it's playing Uno, if it's like throwing rocks in the lake, it always becomes a competition, and I'm going to win, I'm going to beat you, I'm going to destroy you. So, there's that. That's part of being an athlete. You have to have some of that like fire in your belly kind of thing. And then smart is not your GPA, this is your emotional intelligence. How well you know yourself, and how well you know others and can relate to other people. So when you take the combination of this humble, hungry, smart, you get this really ideal spot in the middle where you have someone who combines humility with this desire to do well, but it kind of grinds off some of the like nasty edges of being hungry. And then you go down here and you're smart. A smart person kind of left to themselves is a bit of a conniver, like kind of just like, they're almost like sneaky politician-y kind of like, you're like, am I really believing what you're saying all the time? Or are you just kind of working me, right? So that's kind of like the smart all by itself. But when you take these three things, you get this ideal team player, we'll call it. So if we take this now into the different contexts that you can think of yourself, let's take it into the classroom. So you go into the classroom, if you are the ideal team player, you're wanting to do your best. You're giving everything that you have. You're using your emotional intelligence. You're humble. Humble comes out in the fact that, okay, in 2 weeks, you've got to meet. You also know that there's a paper due on the Monday when you come back. You're like, man, I'm going to be gone Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. I don't know if I'm going to get that done in time. You know what? I think I'm just going to show up on Monday, and I'm going to put my paper down. You know what? I was at a track and field meet. Sorry. I got it in as quick as I could. Or you show up 2 weeks ahead of time and say, I can see this coming. I'm just wondering, is there any possible way that I could maybe get an extension, or what can we do about that? That professor then looks at you and goes, I like that. They're taking some initiative, right? They're coming and asking. They're not just assuming. They're not just saying, oh, because of my outfit, I get to do whatever I want, right? You're not just skipping out on class and just kind of showing up whenever you want, not really contributing. There's group work. You know what? I don't want to be a part of that. So that's what that maybe looks like in the classroom. Then let's take that into the cafeteria, into dorm life, right? If you combine the humble, hungry, smart, you actually want to invest into the dorm life because there's some really good things about the dorm life that are very different from just being a part of your team. Different people. You could, you know, wear the gear, walk around like, yeah, no, I'm an athlete. I don't need to talk to you. I don't need... Or you invest in their life and you realize, man, there are some great people in the dorm. And I know they struggle with the same things as me, but they kind of look at me and think, I don't struggle with that. I totally struggle with that. I'm a very real person. We are all the same. Just because I have a little more gear than you doesn't make me any different than you. So you go in with humility, the hunger to be a part of it, to be like a contributing part of it, and the emotional intelligence to see, man, you know what, I can take that person out for a cup of coffee because I know they're struggling. And then they show up and they actually, when we have a meet and you want to have people there watching you, they're like, I'm happy to come and watch you. You've invested in my life. I'm happy to come and invest and see what you do outside of the dorm, outside of just kind of your regular life. If we take this into a weekend when you don't have a meet. So you could decide, okay, I don't have anything. I'm gonna go out. We're gonna have a huge party. There's gonna be a ton of alcohol. We're gonna make a bunch of stupid decisions. And I hope that it's a really good time, and I hope we don't get caught. That could be one way of approaching time off. The other way to approach time off is to go, I know that there's a whole bunch of people out in the Eastern Fraser Valley right now that their homes have just been destroyed. We could do something about that. We could actually get together. We could go up there. It doesn't take anything but our time, a little bit of muscle that we have lots of right now, and we're going to go and help in that scenario. So there's all kinds of decision-making that come down with your time off. Then if we look at just your athletic life, right? You could be the kind of person, like I said, you know, just all about winning, and you just forget about this, and you go to the meet, you act like a jerk, and you scream at the officials, and you upset at your coaches, and you don't have any time for your teammates. You could act like that. Or you could decide, you know what? No, I'm going to actually be the kind of person that shakes hands before the race, shakes hands after the race, congratulates, even if you maybe just had the most disappointing race of your life, you're like, you know what? I can still give that person a hug. I can still congratulate them in the midst of my, you know, just feeling crappy about myself. You can look around and see on your team, like, who actually, oh man, that person needs a word of encouragement and training. Or you can just stick to yourself and just go, you know, it's all about me. So if you can take this model into every aspect and kind of think through, how do I take humble, hungry, smart into this situation? I think that it will be helpful. Now, we have a few different questions that come up every year. I referenced one of them a little while ago, especially around alcohol. So it's like, well, every team has a different view on what they're gonna do. We have some teams that say, you know what, we're not touching alcohol for our entire season. We have other teams that go, we're just not doing it during playoffs. And we have other teams that go, we're not gonna talk about it, we're just gonna all do it, whatever we wanna do. You as a team get to decide that, but there is a bar. And this is the bar where Carol and I and the rest of our department, if you stay underneath that bar, you're not going to hear from us. If it goes beyond that bar and it comes to our attention, then we're going to be having conversations. So the bar is this. We don't have alcohol on campus. We don't have alcohol on road trips. And if we hear about things where people are just getting flat out drunk, then you're probably having a conversation with us because it's gone too far. So people are always like, what exactly is the line? That's the line, but you as a team may have a discussion and go, you know what? We're gonna go a little bit farther. If I had Cole in here right now, any idea what Cole would be saying in this conversation?
Yeah.
Right? He can't find one shred of academic, scientific evidence for why alcohol would be a part of your life. It's been very interesting, the journey I have seen just in the time that I was a university athlete to now. So, I'll use the world of hockey just because it's kind of ubiquitous with Canadians. There's a guy who is actually one of the founders of BioSteel. His name's Mike Camilleri. When he started playing hockey in the NHL, it was this show up for training camp, go out for pizza and beer at lunch, come back 2 hours later, keep going. That was kind of the culture. Drink as much as you want. That's the way it went. By the time I think he had about a 12, 15 year career in the NHL, it's like guys were taking the entire NHL season off, no alcohol. Totally caring what's going in their bodies. Fruit, vegetables, you name it. High idea around what is nutritious and what is not. That's where the bar has come in sport. We know way more about what things do and what they don't do. So we leave it up to your team. If you as a leadership group on this team want to have a discussion and go, you know what? We're gonna set a really high bar with that. Totally fine by us, but you kind of know where the base level is. The other thing that we have not talked about in years gone by, but is becoming more and more a part of just what people are willing to talk about, which is good because stuff that gets left in the dark basically is not very often very healthy. So that's the whole idea around the harassment. Give me the other word that people are, maltreatment. Harassment and maltreatment. So for a long time, it was kind of like sport was one of those areas where you could have a lot of people treating each other really poorly. Generally, it was adults treating athletes really poorly. Sometimes it was athlete to athlete. Sometimes it might have been athlete to coach, but generally speaking, it was coach to athlete. Maybe it was some of the hazing, particularly, would have been athlete to athlete. And there's no tolerance for that. We don't want that to be anybody's experience at Trinity Western. We don't want it to be the kind of thing where you come in as a rookie and you feel like, oh, I now have to do X, Y, and Z to be accepted onto this team. Okay? That is not what we want for anybody. And if that has been your experience, either somewhere else or here, then we want to be able to help with it. And we have people who are actually trained to help people walk that out. How many of you followed about 3 or 4 weeks ago now the Kyle Beach story that took place in the NHL? Anyone follow that? Okay. So that is a guy who, at 20 years of age, was sexually abused by the video coordinator of the Chicago Blackhawks in the middle of the Stanley Cup run. They went on to win the Stanley Cup that year. They were made aware of the situation. They did nothing about it because they didn't want to disturb team culture on the way to the Stanley Cup. The Stanley Cup was more important than what had happened to this guy. He reported it to a few different people. They didn't do anything about it. They had lots of conversations about it, still did nothing about it. At the end of that year, they quietly said goodbye to him and let him go to a different organization where he promptly there abused a 15-year-old who then got his parents involved, who then finally this guy gets put in jail and it comes back, oh, actually this has been a pattern in this person's life. We don't want that to be anybody's experience. Where if something like that happens, you don't feel like you have someone that you can go and talk to. So if it's happening peer-to-peer, I'm hoping that you can talk to one of your coaches. If you don't feel like you can talk to your coach, then you could talk to Carol, you could talk to myself, you could talk to Sam. You can talk to people outside of the athletic department in the wellness center for that kind of thing. If it's happening from a coach, and you're like, well, clearly I'm not going and talking to the coach, well, then that's definitely where, the department wants to hear about that, and or people that are in the university. It's not easy to deal with. We get that. It's very hard. There's a lot of shame involved in it and that kind of thing. But we just have to be very clear that we don't want this to be some kind of secret that you're like, oh, I've never really heard anyone at Trinity talk about it, so I don't really know what I want to do. There are people trained on campus as officers to take your story very seriously. Maybe it has happened completely outside of the sporting context. Maybe it's happened in a dorm. Maybe it's happened off campus, right? These things all are very real, and we don't want you dealing with that by yourself. Slightly related is the idea of what you are doing by yourself, on your phone, filming, sending to people, putting on Instagram, Snapchat, wherever it may go. We have unfortunately had incidents where people film themselves doing different things in very vulnerable, compromising positions, and then the wrong people get a hold of that. And then that gets used to extort you, to shame you, to embarrass you, to try to get money from you. That is real. It has happened at Trinity Western. It's happening all over the world, unfortunately. So we just need you to know you have to be so careful about what is going on social media, what is going on your phone, and how that stuff gets used. We have had it where the people are actually in Trinity Western gear. So then it gets put out there, and it's like, now that's coming back on the athletic department, and it's coming back on the entire university. So clearly we don't want that happening, but we're actually more concerned for the people involved in it necessarily than our own reputation, even though our reputation is really important for us as well. So I hope that gives you some idea of just the support that is available, and just the wisdom that we need to all use as we are on our phones and on social media, that kind of thing. Is there any questions on that? I know it might be hard to ask a question, but...